all pray together. Mighty Savior, we come before you this night. We're so thankful, Lord, for thy goodness and thy mercy. So thankful, Lord Jesus, that we can come before you, Lord, and worship you in spirit and truth. Bless each and every song of Zion this night, Lord Jesus, and we glorify you and lift you up, mighty Jesus. Help us each and every one to lay aside all the weights that so easily beset us, Lord, and to worship you in spirit and in truth. Truly lift you up when we glorify you, Lord. We just ask that you bless this service this night, mighty Jesus. Truly we give you the praise, the glory, and the honor. In Jesus' precious name we ask it. Amen. If you wonder where the pastor is, he's at home in bed.
Well, hey. 120.
Thank you. stuff. I'm thinking enough. Her ankle.
There's
a boy. My ankle's got a cramp in it.
I don't think they know that song.
Okay, what's your song?
It's page 390. There's power in the blood.
Amen. Yes, sir. See him again tomorrow. So anyway, just pray for him. He really doesn't want to go in the hospital, but you know, I told him, I said, if that's what the doctor thinks you need to do, then that's what we need to do. I hate to make another bill. And I said, you know what? There's going to be bills compared to the time that the Lord comes, and it truly is. So anyway, just remember him and lift him up before the Lord. Sister, one.
I wasn't here Tuesday night, but I was just wondering how Chris was with his wreck and all. Did he get hurt? Did he get wrecked?
He was pretty sore.
Just really sore.
No, nothing broken.
Okay. Truck was totaled, they said.
He had his hand over it, didn't he?
Yes, he did. Absolutely. Sister Betty, did you have your hand up, honey?
Especially.
Okay. Brother Chuck?
Remember my brother Mike? She's sick.
Amen. How are we doing with clothing and stuff for our trip to Montana?
We still need some.
We still need clothing, shoes, school supplies, paper, pencils, backpacks, anything like that there. It'd be greatly appreciated. Brother Chuck will be leaving. When are you leaving?
School's out on the 30th, probably within the next 2 weeks.
Amen. So anyway, just remember that. Sister Gobby.
Remember, baby, don't leave no families, and remember Sister Jenny.
Yes, absolutely. Remember Sister Jenny, and lift her up before the Lord. Amen. Sister Caroline.
Remember all my children and grandchildren, especially remember Harold. I'm telling you, it's sad. He let his wife come there and back home, Mike, and she goes her way in, but it just a divided house. It just don't seem right. And I think it's messing Hannah up and holding in, you know, all this. And then remember Melissa, she went in for all these tests today, but she won't know if it's Friday or Monday, but I'm blaming God for it.
Amen. Amen. Sister Ange.
Remember my sister, they had rushed her to the ER today. And then remember one of my coworkers, they had rushed her to the ER today. While that works, this woman is welcome.
Amen. Sister Janice.
Pray the Lord bring down the price of gasoline for us. Pray he brings it way down.
That would be great, wouldn't it?
And pray for job situation out there for people that are desperate for God, people that are desperate that have a home to live in and food and, you know, protection from the weather. Pray for our soldiers that God's warning and protecting angels will go before them and that we have to come back home. And pray for all the soldiers that have been out there but come back, you know, messed up and you know, all kinds of conditions. They need God and they need prayer.
Yes, absolutely. Brother Mark?
You know, pray for probably very well. Go ahead. Of course, God, but that's very love.
Yes, absolutely. Brother Donald?
Continue praying for my friend Roy, my brother-in-law, and a boy we know from our hometown that lives over in Ohio. He's had a bad condition.
Brother Kevin?
Jax.
Mm-hmm.
And Maria.
Good, and then...
I want to rub it.
Amen. Brother Tony, did you have your hand up?
Yeah, he lifted me up. I got real just not long ago. I got the biopsy back on my lung. It was no cancer.
Sister Monica.
Yes, continue to remember my aunt, of course. I talked to Aunt Rhonda last night. They're going to take her and put her back together, basically. She's got a colostomy bag because I sold it up to them a few months ago. So they're going to put her all back together, and I guess she ain't going to have a chemo for 3 months. So she's praying because apparently persistence is paying off.
Amen.
Amen.
Mr. Joy.
Remember my babies, they're in Florida. And remember all my babies, Kimmy and Tasha. I got a disturbing call from my brother-in-law, my nephew today, the one that was in the military that hurt his ankle. They are going to have to take off his leg. To his knee. His wife just beside herself, she's going crazy. But they said if they know what had happened was the screws that they put in his feet and his ankle are the ones that they used and bitten on, and it caused it's like a gangrene, but he called it RID or RDS or something, and so he gave it initials, don't know what it was, they're this long. But anyway, it's a gangrene, but it's in the nerve system. And he said if they don't take it out off, that he's going to end up losing more limbs than what they want. They're going to take it off, and they're looking at July. But he's that's when he can do it. He recommended him to another surgeon that could get him in before then. So he's supposed to let us know, you know. He wasn't a bit upset. He said, you know, I told the Lord, whatever your will is. I'm alive, you know, I thank you for being alive. Whatever you have to do, Lord, just let it be, you know. And I told him that we was praying for him and stuff, and he said, continue to pray for him. Because he's going to need it, because he's got to go through rehabilitation, and then I have to fit him for a prosthetic leg and everything. So just remember that situation. And then we had a situation kind of, it's an unspoken request, but God knows what it is. Just, it's a very, very, very desire, a dire request. God needs to move in this situation in our family. And remember my brothers and sisters. And remember my mom and my dad, and all the ones traveled.
Amen. Amen. Brother Raymond.
Remember Brother
Bud. Amen. Sister Janice went and saw Brother Bud today, and
I know you was going to talk about that.
No, I forgot. Go ahead.
Okay. But anyway, yeah, she said that he was real for her today and everything. So do remember Brother Bud. God's not done. You know, God's still going to. And move on that situation. We believe it. We stand on it, you know, by faith, you know. So anyway, just remember that, Sister Caroline.
And remember all those people.
Yes. Absolutely. Absolutely. Anybody else have a...
Sister Wendy.
Please remember me. There's been some changes at work. And I've been first to
Amen. I thought you took all enough last time, didn't you?
It's not less than
6 months
ago. Yeah.
Yeah. Amen. Well, we should be praying about that. What God wants. Amen. Anybody else? Brother Chuck?
Just remember the family of that soldier over there, name on him, that Muslims beheaded him today.
Yes.
All of them. Right. Out on the streets of England.
Did you see that guy that did it?
Yeah. I don't watch TV.
Had blood all over his hands. He was not off TV.
I don't watch TV, so unless somebody announces it here in church, that's the only way I can. Or if it's been in the Martinsville paper, that's the only way. And I don't read everything in the paper, so.
Remember Tabby?
Yes, absolutely. Absolutely. I haven't heard anything, but do remember Sister Tabby and lift her up before the Lord. She has two little embryos implanted now, and so just lift her up that she will be able to carry the babies.
Amen.
Amen.
And
let's also remember
Pastor. Absolutely. Absolutely. Unspoken request by the uplift of hands
for Lisa.
And remember Sister Lisa. She's working overtime. She said, I'll get here as soon as I can, but they, you know, sometimes it's feast or famine, you know. Let's all pray together. Mighty Savior, we come before you this night. Truly we glorify you, lift you up, and by your holy name. According to your word, Lord, if you be lifted up, that you'll draw all men unto thee, Lord. As we lift you up and we glorify you, we praise you, Lord Jesus, and we worship you in spirit and in truth. We know full well that your word of God says, by your stripes we are healed, that you took our afflictions upon yourself, that we be able to walk in victory. Lord, each and every request that has come up before thee this night, Lord, we know cancer is just a part of that name, but Jesus is above everything, Lord, in heaven and in earth. We know, Lord Jesus, that you're a God that cannot fail. Anything we ask in faith, believing that it shall be done, Lord. We know, Lord Jesus, if we say unto that mountain, to be removed and cast in the sea, wherever not, that it shall be done. We glorify you, we lift you up, and magnify your holy name. Those that need jobs this night, Lord Jesus, we know exactly where that you know exactly where the jobs are, Lord. You know each and everything, Lord. You know that you are the way maker, Lord. This evening to be your way, Lord. All things are possible with you if we can just trust and believe, and we just give you the praise and the glory and the honor. So thank the Lord that we do know, hallelujah, that you're a way maker, Lord. We glorify you, lift you up, and magnify your holy name, Lord, and Savior. So thank the Lord Jesus that you're a God that is able to move in each and every one of these situations, as whether they're spoken or unspoken this night, Lord. Just have your way in each and every one of them. We give you praise, the glory, and the honor. In Jesus' precious name we ask it. Let the church say amen.
Amen.
Amen. God is able.
Yes, he is.
Hallelujah. God is able. Sister Janice said she was going to bless us with a song tonight.
Amen.
Amen.
And tongue or pen can ever tell. It goes beyond the highest star and reaches to the lowest hell. The guilty pair bowed down with care. God gave his son. God's love so sure shall still endure. All measureless and strong, redeeming grace to heaven's race, the saints and angels' songs. O love of God, how rich and pure, how measureless and strong, it shall forevermore endure, the saints and angels' songs. Could we with ink the ocean fill, and were the skies the parchment made, were every stalk under earth a quill, and every man a scribe by trade, to write the love of God above, would drain the ocean dry, nor could the scroll contain the whole, though stretched from sky to sky. O love of God, how rich and pure, how measureless and strong, it shall forevermore endure, the saints and angels' songs.
Amen.
Yeah.
what had happened is I had a field trip, but they canceled it. He had a field trip, and he went on his, and then they called me into school cafeteria because one of the girls had an emergency, so they said, we really need you tomorrow, can you hear? And I said, sure. It just came out of my mouth, you know. I said, sure. She got home, and she said, Mom, what time are you leaving? And I said, for what? And she goes, to go to the airport. And I said, oh, I got to work. She says, I'm going to kill you. You know I have to be there. But I called my mom. My mom and dad was a nervous wreck. They said, well, we'll take her, but we don't know where to take her to. I said, well, just take her somewhere and drop her off. I don't care. And so see if you can find somebody else. And the only one who came to mind was Sister Daisy. And I called her and I said, hi. And she said, hi. I go, yeah, every time I call her, what do you need? I go, I love you. Can you do me a favor? And, but I do. I appreciate Sister Daisy doing that for mercy.
She knows the secret way in there now.
Huh?
She knows the secret way in
there
now.
Yep, I know the secret way in there. Well, I don't know it. The last time we only flown one time, and it was in 2009, so they got that new one over there, and I don't, well, we know where it is, because every time we go to Metropolis, that mall over there, we end up in the airport, because Tim gets turned around. We always end up there. And then we can't find our way out of there. So we get in, we just can't get out anywhere. But I want to sing this song, He Loves Us. And he does love us. And,
yes,
and
he does.
I thank him and praise him. And when Stacy left the house today, my heart just felt like it was coming completely out of my chest. I ain't kidding you. I just bawled and bawled and bawled. And I told the Lord, I said, Lord, whatever you do, please just keep your hands over them and keep them safe. I said, well, Daisy knows why, because Stacy had two suitcases she was trying to pull, and then she had a big purse that they had the baby's books and stuff in it, and Shekinah was following her like a little duck behind her. And I was a nervous wreck, because I said, Stacy, you got to hold on to that baby. Well, she can follow me. And I said, not in an airport, you can't do that. And that, I think that was why my anxiety kicked in, but I don't know, but it felt like my chest was just coming completely out of my body. And I started crying. I said, Lord, I said, that's my heart going there. I said, you take care of them. And the thought came to my mind, well, as you look at your children, that's how I look at you. You're my heart, you know, and when you go away from me, my heart breaks just as much as theirs do. So I get myself together, and I'm bawling and squalling, and I go over to the school, and Sister Lonnie Cook was there, and I said, Lonnie, I need prayer. And she said, what's wrong, Sister Georgia? And I told her, I said, Stacy's leaving. She goes, oh, it's hard, isn't it? I said, yeah. I said, I'll tell you what's hard. I said, she's going to be in Florida, and I can't get my hands to them. That's what it is, Sister Daisy. They're not at arm's length. And, you know, we just worry about them. And she said, yeah. And then again, I thought about the Lord. He cares for us. He wants us to cradle in His bosom. That's where He wants to keep us at. But us being the will that He gives us free will, Sister Daisy. And we always crawl down off of His lap and we do whatever we want. But He's always, always there to pick us up and cradle us back where He belongs. And it makes Him happy. And I was just a bawling all day. I'm a big crybaby, but I can't help it. But she texted me and she said, Mom, we made it just fine. And she said, first thing she did, she called me and she said, Mother? And I said, yes. She said, I just had to call you. And I said, what's wrong? And she said, nothing. I just want to tell you that they wouldn't let me pull the luggage. They took the luggage so I can have a hold of my daughter. And I said, thank you, Jesus. That was the first thing that came out of my mind, because, you know, that was my worst fear. And then I get here at church night, they said, I prayed and prayed and prayed that she'd get over that kid. And I told her, but God is mindful of us, and He knows exactly what we need before we even ask Him, and He does love us. So it's in C and then A minor, and then G and then F. It's backwards. C, A minor, G, and F, yeah.
Yeah. I'm
pushing.
It led me to the chapter, 12th chapter of Romans.
12th chapter of Romans. Romans
3-8.
I'll see the microphone, please. Romans 12.
It says, for I say, through the grace given unto me, to every man that is among you, not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think, but to think soberly, according as God hath dealt to every man the measure of faith. Whereas we have many members in one body, and all members have not the same office. We also, being many, are one body in Christ, and every one members one of another. Having been gifts differing according to the grace that is given unto us, or given to us, whether prophecy, let us prophesy according to the proportion of faith. Or ministry, let us wait on our ministry.
Oh, you're scaring me.
Or he that teacheth on teaching. Or he that exhorteth on the exhortation. He that giveth, let him give. Let him do it with simplicity. He that ruleth with diligence. He that showeth mercy with cheerfulness. And, I believe in all the gifts. I believe if you want the gifts, ask of God, and He will give
yes,
them
he
to
will,
you.
Yes,
I believe that with all my heart. I know a lot of people don't believe in speaking in tongues. Personally, I do.
Amen.
And I do quite often. As I go to pray for someone, I will start out in English, but it soon turns to tongues, and I just can't hold it back.
Hallelujah.
I just open my mouth and God fills it.
Yes, He does.
And I'd also like to read this a little bit in 1 Corinthians 1, chapter 1, 4 through 9. I thank my God always on your behalf for the grace of God which is given you by Jesus Christ, that in everything you are enriched by Him, in all utterance and in all knowledge, even as the testimony of Christ was confirmed in me. So that you come behind in no gift, waiting for the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, who shall also confirm you unto the end, that you may be blameless in the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. God is faithful, by whom you were called unto the fellowship of His Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
I'd also like to read verse 25. Because the foolish of God is wiser than men. The foolishness of God is wiser than men. And the weakness of God is stronger than men. And I don't really know if God had any foolishness. Evidently He did, because it said so. Even His foolishness is stronger, is wiser than men. And First Peter 4, 10 and 11. It says, as every man hath received the gift, even so minister the same one to another as good stewards of the manifold grace of God. If any man speak, let him speak as the oracles of God. If any man ministers, let him do it as of the ability which God giveth, that God in all things may be glorified through Jesus Christ, to whom be praise and dominion forever and ever. Amen. You know, when I was first saved, I give my heart to the Lord at the altar, and then at Man of Mission. I was in a really, really bad shape. I was in a state of depression. I was on 23 different medications. I take every day. I don't know very many people that go through depression, but I know there's quite a few. They just want to get you up to a level, a doctor does, just a level enough to where you will do anything the doctor tells you to do. It's just what it amounts to. And it gives you no room for your own thoughts. I mean, anything to come good out of it, there's no room for it. I mean, you're just like in a daze. But when I got up from the altar, I spoke in tongues at the altar to give my heart to the Lord. And I didn't speak in tongues again for a long time. But I was still going to church regularly. I quit doing all the things that I used to do. Me and Brother Mark quit drinking together. As a matter of fact, me and a lot of people quit drinking together. But it wasn't that they didn't want to buy me one, I'll tell you that. It's because I didn't want. I just did not want the things that used to be on. And I prayed to the Lord to take me off all of them medications. He's took me off of almost every one of those medications that I'm taking.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus. And he's changed my heart. Where I was mean to my family. For 25 years, me and my wife, we had a very bad marriage. We fought constantly the first 3 years. We were married when I was 18 years old. We didn't know nothing about marriage. How to keep a marriage. After 25 years, God called me, and I turned my life over to him. He changed it. I mean, he changed it tremendously. And I love him for it. He took that old stony heart out of me, like it says in Ezekiel 11:19. It says to take your stony heart out and put you in a heart of flesh.
Amen.
And that's exactly what he done for me.
Yes,
and so after the 25 years and me giving my life to the Lord, our marriage has been wonderful. There's no more. so.
Oh, I do.
I had a sister that asked me to go to church with her. She went to church down on South Highland Street. West Highland, yeah. Sister Pat Cook's church. I asked my older brother Jim to go. And so we showed up down there that night. There's supposed to be a special speaker there from North Carolina. His name was Ramsey.
Ramsey.
I think he
was there at
night. He was around 75 years old, I think, somewhere in there. And he preached a good message. And after he got through preaching, he asked people if they needed prayer to come down, and he would pray for them. And we were sitting all the way in the back, and people, he'd just touch the top of their head, and they just followed. Just everyone, he just fell over. And I looked at my brother, and I said, "That guy's phony." I've never seen anything like that in my life. And I said, "I'm going down there and show you." So I stood up and I started walking down the edge of the wall, and he was over in this corner praying for people. And I got halfway down that hall and I started crying.
Yeah.
I mean, the tears were just rolling down my face. I thought, "Lord, what am I doing crying? I don't have anything to cry about." I looked over at him and he made eye contact with me. And he started to grin. I said, "Here I am crying and that man's grinning. Something's not right. He's got to be a phony." So I went on down and stopped him, and he met me right there. And he didn't say a word to me. Not one word. And he just took his hand and touched the top of my head.
Hallelujah.
And that's all I could do, just stand there and raise my arms to God and speak in tongues. And that's all I could do. I tell you, it felt like a bolt of lightning that went through my body. I mean, from the top of my head to the sole of my feet. And I don't know how long I stood there and praised God. But when I got enough composure to turn around and go back to my seat, I reached out and took a hold of my brother Jim's hand. I said, "Come on, you've got to have this man pray for you." And he got up, and he just about run down there. And he was there, and he done the very same thing to him, and Jesus filled him with the Holy Ghost. I mean, just immediately, and speaking in tongues. And he told me, "I'm getting baptized tonight." I said, "Well, I'm going to wait and let my pastor, Tom, baptize me." And we've been in church ever since. But there was four of us brothers saved within 1 year. And, so our whole family is going to church, all but one. That's pretty good out of 12, I guess. But I just thank God for what He does for me each and every day, and I thank Him for His Word. I thank Him for His gifts. I tell you, if you don't want to speak in tongues, don't speak in tongues. The only thing I can say.
You don't know you desire the gift of praying in tongues.
But I wanted to speak in tongues, and I prayed. I'd pray every night to speak in tongues, and it just wouldn't come. I prayed for 2 years, and I talked to Brother Charlie about it. Brother Charlie Hatton, and I was telling him about it. He said, "Ram said you don't have to beg for a gift. He said it's free. God gives you something, it's free." And one night I was laying in bed praying, and my wife, she just reached over and touched my chest and started praying for me. And the tongues come. And I mean, I haven't shut up since. I was with Brother Mark, and he asked me to go to down to the Gulf with him and pray for his uncle, which was, I think he had cancer. And he said, but I don't know if you ought to pray in tongues around. I said, well, you know, I don't know if I'll go. I don't know if I can stop it. I never had a desire to stop. I mean, if I'm going to pray for somebody, I'm going to pray for them like I pray for them. I mean, don't ask somebody to pray for you, then tell them how to pray. You might tell them what to pray or what you need prayer for, but don't tell them how to pray. And so we went to Florida, down to the Gulf, and went to his uncle's house. And we was praying for him. He asked his uncle if we could pray for him. He said, yeah. And so we prayed for him. And, you know, I wasn't a half a minute into the prayer, and I was off in tongues. But the man thought it was wonderful. I mean, he just thought it was wonderful. I went and prayed for another family member of his and gave him a prayer blanket. And you know those prayer blankets, they work.
Yes, they do.
They sure work. You know, you don't know what prayer everybody's praying and what prayer God's going to answer. I've known a lot of people that have took those prayer blankets, and I've seen them in the casket with them. They took them with them. But I was actually going to save this for a Sunday. But I think Brother Roy's going to come and save me. But that's all I have tonight. Anyway. I just think that.
I know when Brother Roy started ministering over to the other church, he got me interested in some of the evangelists that he was talking about. So I went to the library and started getting that book and started reading some of their lives. And they did some marvelous things, but really we've done some marvelous things too. And we ought to bring that more out, because the more you bring that out, the more you stir that up, the more that we can receive it and believe it. I just want to say, anybody here follow basketball? No? I follow just a little bit, but the Pacers, the Indianapolis Pacers, they're in the playoffs. And so they played last night, and I can't watch them because I care a little bit if they win. And so because I care if they win, I get nervous watching them, so I can't enjoy it. I get too excited. So I don't watch them, I read about them the next day. And I was thinking last night, I wasn't watching, I was just kind of keeping up with the score off and on, but they lost in overtime. And how that God is so good, because they played now for a couple weeks in the playoffs, and the last time they won a game, they played at the normal time on TV, and then like 3 o'clock in the morning, they replayed it. Well, I woke up at 3 o'clock in the morning, and I watched the game, because I knew that we were going to win, I could enjoy it. And God is so good, because He lets us know that we are going to win. Yeah. God, and also God, I love you tonight.
God did, God set him up back here, even though it was something bad, that happened. God set him up back here as a child to put him in place in the future where he needed to be. And if he had moaned and groaned and complained and whined and cried and just threw up his hands and says, that's it, I'm done. Forget this. Nothing's going right. Everything's bad. Nothing good ever happens to me. I'm just going to sit here and die. Then Joseph would not have been in a spot to save his family all those years later. When the famine came and his brothers came, he would not have been in that spot to save his family and bring them into Egypt. Amen. Now think about that. We have one little thing happen to us, and we throw up our hands and say, that's it, I'm done. I'm not doing that anymore. I'm not trying anymore. And we sit down and we stop. We don't know how far in the future our promise is. We don't know if it's a week from now, a year from now, 10 years from now, 20 years from now. God gives us a vision, as he did Joseph. It's going to come to pass, but we got to keep moving forward and not stopping. And too many people as Christians stop when things get hard. Like I said, you got to remember, always think of this, and it's why it stuck with me. Remember, and when times get hard and things are going bad in your eyes, it isn't because you're doing things wrong, it's probably because you're doing things right. You're probably doing the things God wants you to do. I stopped and thought in the last about month and a half or so of my ups and downs in my life. And I've had my little crying fits and this and that because things just weren't going my way. Everybody was saying this and doing this, whether it was in my personal life, in my work life. I was getting attacked on every side. I was getting told I wasn't fit to do this, I couldn't do that, I shouldn't be doing this. It didn't matter. And I got down. And you know, I stopped and thought about this, and I'm thankful I have a wonderful husband who just let me cry on his shoulder, and he lifted me up. He prayed peace into me. Because it got me to stop and think. Something good's about to happen. If the devil's fighting me this hard right now, there's something good going to come out of this. Amen. And I stopped and I thought about this. You know, things are moving in a direction now. We had a gentleman leave at work today. And he's put in his notice, he's leaving. And then my boss, who's only been there about a month and a half, has then steps up to me and says, hey, would you like to take over this area too? He said, I really like your work. You're doing a good job. And it's time to maybe promote you up a little bit further. And I'm going, whoa, wait a minute. But then I stop and think, you know, God's awesome. Because God puts me in the position to where I can move along. If I do what God wants me to do here, even though I may have a battle over here, it's going to come out better over here. And that's the thing with Joseph. He started out serving God back here. He had a battle, and things got better. Had a battle, things got better. Had a battle, things got better. Till finally he was in a position of power. Amen. He was in a position that he could take care of the people he wanted to take care of. All right. And it took several years. But no matter what, how long it takes or what we go through, whatever God promised us back here will definitely come out over here. Amen.
I could have gone on this Tuesday night, but I couldn't remember the scripture. I've heard Brother Pat quote it time and time again. Looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising... Hebrews chapter 12, verse 1. Wherefore, since we also are compassed about with so great a cloud of witness, let us lay aside our sins, and the sin which doth so easily beset us, and let us run with patience the race that is set before us. Most of you know my deal with patience. I had a truck that I nicknamed Patience, and keyword had. I broke it. To learn patience, you've got to go through trials and tribulation. And here about, what was it, a week and a half ago, when I dropped that little clue to you about Peter, I went back to the whole patience thing. Because sometimes we have to wait upon God. A lot of times, we get ourselves in the predicament because we step out too soon. And I told Wendy, I said, where would Peter be if he had not waited upon Jesus before he stepped out of the boat? Think about that. How many times do we step out and do things and we jump too early? I'm guilty. And 90% of the time, it all comes around, but 90% of the time, I've messed things up because I got my hands into it. I've learned the patience, I've learned to endure, and God has finally beat it into me, like I told you the other night, when to keep my mouth shut. It's a hard road. Not all of us can go through it. Just like Brother Raymond, I was nasty, rude, crude. I hated my own family. I feel for you. I look at you and see what I can become as long as I persevere.
Amen.
I know a lot of your family and my family kind of grew up together, probably sat on the same bar stools together. We can walk down the same road together because Jesus sent the disciples out, not one at a time, two by two. So we need that second person sometimes to just hold on to us and pull us back in the boat because we're ready to jump out. Think about that. Where would we be? Where would Peter be if he would have stepped out too soon?
Amen.
I made a couple of days ago, the Lord put it up in my heart. I didn't know what it was for, but I know what it's for now. So,
all right.
Brought it to church, and we're going to bring it in.
All right.
So, you know, I thank the Lord, and I something that He showed me the other day. In 1992, I left Shell. And I left a very good job, making lots of money. And
God's money.
Plenty of security to go do God's work. And to show you how God takes care of you, I had no idea that I would ever get retirement. I didn't know whether I was vested or not. My wife told me, if we're going to walk this thing by faith, just go down, turn in your resignation, and God will take care of it. And I did that very thing. Had I left when God first put it in my heart about it, I wouldn't have been vested. But I waited because I wanted to make sure it was God and not me. When we, or the Lord, made the decision about what we're fixing to do here at the end of the month, I waited and waited and waited several months to even give Pastor Daisy the letter that I gave her. And then I waited before I went and talked to her. And the reason why, I wanted to make sure it was God and not me. And when God is in it, everything works fine. not a problem. And I made this because there's a gift. I think every time you come to church, you ought to expect a gift. God's got something for you every time you come. And you know the person up here? That just happens to be the element that God is working through to bring the gift to you. All the gifts come from God.
Yes, they do.
So this gift comes from God. I wrapped this personally myself. Nice
job. Nice job.
Yes. So Junior, if you'll come up here tonight, because I didn't know it until I got here that it's Junior's birthday. So who better to receive the gift than somebody that has a birthday? Better, because I want you to read that text that's wrote on it and show everybody what this is. And by the way, I used your jigsaw saw to cut this out.
So.
You have to turn it. Garage, so I might as well
use it. Along with the rest of your junk, you need to come here.
What is that? It's a key.
Matthew 6:33.
Yes. Show everybody the key. That's kind of accurate. I cut that out of a piece of cedar shim stock, by the way. But, and I put the little indentions on there. Use nail polish to make it stand out. So that's yours. And I want you to keep that, because that right there is the key to life. If you never memorize, and by the way, the next time I see you, I want you to tell me what the verse is without looking it up. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added unto you.
Amen.
And it doesn't make any difference. That verse is not just for an individual. That's for everybody in the body of Christ.
Amen.
That's for every church.
Amen.
If a church can grab a hold of what that key says, if a church can grab a hold of what that key says and seek God first, seek Him first in everything that we do.
Amen.
If we seek Him first, all the things, which, what things? Anything you need. Anything you have need of, He says it's there. That He wants to be first in your life.
Absolutely.
And that's the hardest thing for us, is because we want to put so many things before.
Amen.
And He wants us to depend on Him and put Him first.
Amen.
Sister Daisy.
Sister Daisy. Sister Daisy.
Jesus, well,
you know, I was going to be the, I intended to speak tonight. And I don't know, the Lord just really impressed upon me to call the ministers to have a word tonight. And everything was really wonderful that was spoken tonight. And that really just topped it all off, because that it truly is. We have to seek God first in anything and everything that we do. He should be number one in our life. He should be the one that we consult before we do anything. If we go out to buy a car, we need to consult Him before we ever do it. Whatever we need to do in our life, we need to consult Him first. And He will add all these things unto us if He is number one. Well, my message tonight, the Lord gave me this afternoon, and I preached this a long time ago, but it just really stuck with me. And so in St. John chapter 15, most of you know it, but this is what the Lord really laid on my heart. I am the true vine, and my Father is the husbandman. Every branch in me that beareth not fruit, He taketh away. And every branch that beareth fruit, He purgeth it, that it may bring forth more fruit. Now we are clean through the word
which I have spoken unto you. These are Jesus' words that is that he's speaking these words. We are clean, cleansed, every one of us, by this word. This word right here. That's what cleanses us. Hallelujah. Abide in me, and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit of itself, except it abide in the vine, and no more can ye, except you abide in me. You know, if you take a tree limb and you cut it off, that limb is going to dry up and die because it doesn't have the sustaining fluids from the tree. And it's the same way in God. Unless you abide in him, you will die. Not only a natural death, spiritually you will die. So we have to abide in him. You know what? It's like the marrow in us, in our bones. There's a marrow. And, you know, I was so amazed when I saw my grandson receive a marrow transplant. You always think, I don't know what I really thought it would do or how it would be, but when they took it from my other grandson to give it to him, and then they took it and cleaned it all up, got all the bone fragments out of it and everything, then they put it in an IV, and I thought, well, how in the world is that going to know where it's supposed to go? Did you ever really think about that? How does that marrow know where it's supposed to go to? In an IV. You really would, you know, because it's going into the inner parts of your bone. But see, it's the same way with Jesus. Jesus is within us. And he's the one that is leading and guiding us. If your bone marrow is no good that is in you, it won't do, you know, you're going to die. You know, that was why whenever you have leukemia or you have aplastic anemia, that they sometimes try a bone marrow transplant. Well, my grandson, when he had his, it was just like he had a twin. My grandmother, grandson, even though they were 13 months apart, and doctor come in and he looked at us and he said, I cannot believe this. It's as if they are identical twins. And they were 13 months apart. But see, that was God.
Amen.
That was God.
Right.
Whenever he first came, they took him to the hospital and he was diagnosed, he came to church, and we were in revival, most of the, everybody that, Sister Wendy and Brother Tony, they were part of our church back then. And he come to church, and Brother Lovell, Brother Love, happened to be in revival. He come to church, first thing he did, he got prayed for. He continued to believe, no matter what he went through, that he was healed. He'd tell the doctors, I'm healed. I am healed. And he went through all the chemo in 6 days. They did the chemo in 6 days, all of it, to where so they could give him the bone marrow faster because he was deteriorating very, very fast. But see, God knew exactly what he was doing. God does know. And if we don't abide in God, and we don't live in him, when it says abide, it means live in him. We have to live in God. In everything we do, we have to put God first. He is such a great and mighty God. We can depend upon him. As Brother Roy said, if we can only learn those scriptures and know, hallelujah, for a fact, that he is a God that we can depend upon. And he is our bone marrow. He is our marrow. He is within us. He lives there. Hallelujah. If we allow him. My God is a gentleman. He does not force himself on anybody that doesn't want him. If you don't want the Holy Ghost speaking in tongues, you don't have to have it. And I wasn't sure what Brother Roy was going to do when he handed him that gift. I thought he was going to tell him not to open it right away is what I really thought. I thought he was going to do the demonstration a little bit about the Holy Ghost. Because, you know, God gave us a gift. But unless we open that gift up, we will never see what is in there.
Amen.
And it's the same way if we don't open the gift that God has given us. And God's given us a gift. God absolutely has given us a gift. And if we abide in that gift, that he has given us if we abide in the vine. He is the vine. He is the vine. He's the vine. He's the rock. You can just go through the Bible and you can find all kinds of names that he is. We have to abide in him. Hallelujah. Said, I am the vine. Ye are the branches. He that abideth in me, and I in him, the same bringeth forth much fruit. For without me, you can do nothing. I mean, that word is pretty plain, isn't it? We can't do nothing. I believe Tuesday night I read the 13th chapter of 1 Corinthians. That's one of my very favorite scriptures. You can be the greatest prophet, the greatest teacher that could ever be. Hallelujah. But if you don't have love, you're not anything.
Amen.
You're the same as dough. If you do not have love. And if we do not have God in our life, just because you're a good man, you can be a good man. Are you a good man?
Sometimes.
Yes, he's rotten, that's for sure. Wendy gets him all excited.
You put the big one, well, I put the beat of the lemon.
God is good. God is the one that we have to stay in. We have to abide in him. Hallelujah. If a man abide in me, abide not in me, he is cast forth as a branch and is withered. And men gather them and cast them into a fire, and they are burned. And one of these days, that's exactly what's going to happen. Amen. Unless you abide in him, you will be burned in a fire forever and ever and ever. The fire will not be quenched. Hallelujah. But as long as we abide in him, we trust him and let him live in us. Hallelujah. And let him guide us. It said the Holy Ghost would be our comforter, would be our guide, it'll be our teacher.
Amen.
But if we don't let him teach us, if you don't let him guide us, hallelujah, we will be cast aside. Hallelujah. He is a good God, and I love him with all my heart. The word has been good tonight. Hallelujah. I thank him for the word of God. It's a word of God that is going to save our soul. It's a word of God when everything's going wrong, when those trials come, it's the word of God that's going to help you get through those trials. As Sister Wendy was talking about Joseph. Joseph went through things. How many of us have gone through things? Every one of us that is sitting here tonight have had our trials. We've had our shortcomings. We've had things that we've had to face that we just thought that we couldn't get through it. But with God, all things are possible if we can only believe. If we can only believe. If we only have the faith of a grain of mustard seed, it says. Hallelujah. We can say unto that mountain, to be thou removed and cast into the sea. Let it not, and it shall be done. Hallelujah. Caroline stood on the word of God, said, my granddaughter has not got cancer. When her granddaughter was in Afghanistan, faithfully, every night, she prayed for her. Hallelujah. We have to stand on the word of God. We have to believe him, no matter what it looks like, no matter what kind of things is going on in our life, we have to believe God.
Amen.
He is a God that we can depend upon. Maybe we can't depend on ourselves, or we may not be able to depend upon our brother, but one thing I can say, we can depend upon Jesus. Hallelujah. You know what I'm talking about. I'm talking about living, making God your everything.
Yes.
Making God your everything. Not your job.
Yes.
Oh, it's good to have a good job.
Amen.
It's nice to have a nice home. You know what? We talk about it quite often, what the things that sometimes we gave up. But the things we have given up is nothing compared
Amen.
To the reward that we will have someday. I thought, you know, we had a really nice place in Minneapolis. We had a 4-bedroom home. A very nice, Brother Pat and I both had good jobs. And you know what? It don't mean nothing. Don't mean nothing. I'm just as happy to have four little rooms that the floors are all over which way. then really, really, I mean, my floors is every which way in it. I step out the back door on that step, and sometimes I stumble and almost fall off of it. And I say, thank you, Lord, I thank you, Lord, I thank you, Lord, because it don't matter. I said, I told the Lord many years ago, if I had you, I'd live in a tent. And I would. I proved that.
You lived in a camper?
I lived in a little camper that was just tied in. Hallelujah. All it had in it was just the couch let out into a bed because we let somebody else use it and it tore everything out of it. So I was always in there. And then it finally got so hot, we had to move in with a mattress on the Sunday school floor. On the floor. And the furnace room was our kitchen.
Yeah.
I had a microwave, electric skillet, and a little bitty refrigerator. That was our kitchen, was the furnace room. So you know how much room was in the furnace room at the old building. But God's good and it don't matter. It does not matter where we're at as long as we're serving the Lord. As long as we let Him be our light and guide us. Hallelujah. It don't make any difference. You know what? We're not going to take anything with us when we go. Nothing's going to go with it. When the pharaohs and all of them were buried in their the tombs and things, and they took all their riches and all their golds and everything with them. Oh, but you know what? That is still there.
Still there.
Still there to be shared with someone else. Or the ones that had found it, whether it was for the country or whether it was personally. It didn't go with them. Nothing, you're not going to take anything out of here. The only thing that, hallelujah, that you're going to do is you're going to be with the one who died for you. The one who bled and died for you. The one who suffered those stripes for your healing. Hallelujah. God is a miracle worker. We saw God do so many miracles. I give the testimony how Sister Lisa absolutely died when she was 2 years old. And God brought her back to life. Why? Because He knew she, down the road, as Sister Wendy said, down the road, she had a work to do. God is able to meet those needs that we have in our life. God is able to heal. God is able to set free. And I see Sister Lisa just coming down the pathway, down the cycle, right, Kevin?
Yeah, Sister Daisy.